Hello, subprograms are one of the later things in the programming topic at GCSE, and students, in my experience, have often found these quite hard, especially because it somewhat undoes a lot of what you've learned about so far, and there are lots of terms which are introduced at this point which can be confusing. I'm going to do my best to go through these terms in this video, and it'll take a few more videos to cover all the things needed. We'll look at the two main types of subprogram, procedures and functions, separately, although the code we'll look at today involves procedures. Let's start though by defining subprogram, because that is our overriding term which we have to get our head around. So subprogram is a named out of line block of code that runs when called. And if this is still fairly new to you, that won't make any sense at all. Even if you do understand what these are, that might still be a little bit confusing. Let's break down what that definition actually means with some code. So here is some OCR ERL code. What I've got at the top here is a subprogram with a name show greeting. That's what I mean by it being named. I give it a name like I would give a variable or an array a name. I give it a name which is formally called the identifier. So here it's called show greeting. The block of code which I'm referring to is shown here. In ERL, we start with either procedure or function, and then either end procedure or end function. In Python, it's def, and then we just unindent to end it. This is our block of code. That is really the subprogram itself. And this initial block of code is often called the definition of the subprogram. At the bottom, below it, any code which is unindented and outside of this block is part of our main program. So our main program will contain other bits of code, like I've got a couple of print lines here, but I've also got a calling line. So this line here is me calling the subprogram. That's a formal word for it, call. Calling it means I'm telling it to run. So this code at the top only runs if I include a calling line to tell it to run. The out of line part is really important to understand, because it can be described as being out of line because the code in the subprogram runs out of sequence. The normal sequence, unless you've got if statements, unless you've got loops, is to run line by line, top to bottom. However, calling breaks this top to bottom approach, because I would print welcome, I would then run show greeting, and this will jump up to run the code in the subprogram. This name equals input line will run first, then it will run the print. Then, when it's done, it will jump back down to where the calling line was, and it will continue. So let's look at it running in this ERL interpreter. So if I run this code, I first see welcome, then I see what is your name. I type in Mr. Brown, I press enter, it says good to see you, then it says goodbye. But we need to understand and really visualize the order in which this has been done and what the computer is doing when the code is running. So the interpreter, when it's trying to run this code, we'll look at the first line first, right? It does go top to bottom still. However, it does not really do anything relating to the first four lines of this program. It'll basically go, oh, okay, you've got a procedure called show greeting. It will note away if you've got that, but it will ignore line 2 and line 3 and, well, line 4. Because it will ignore the subprograms until they are called. The first line to actually properly run is line 6, where we get welcome outputted. We then would run line 7, which is a calling line, which tells the computer to jump up and run where it knew the definition started. It would run line 2, we ask for the name, it would run line 3, it prints out this message. Then the procedure has ended, so it jumps back down to line 7. It doesn't just continue from where it was again, it doesn't go line 6 again. It jumps back down to where it was called. And then it will just continue as normal, hence why we get goodbye afterwards. So that jumping up and down is really important to visualize, because it explains the sequencing and explains various errors which could occur potentially. Because, for example, we can't call a subprogram above the definition, because it doesn't know what that is yet. It hasn't learned that that's where the definition is yet. So I can't call it before it's been defined. However, after that point, I can call it wherever I want to call it, because every time it sees a calling line, it will run the subprogram code. And that's partly why we use subprograms, because they are very, very good at reusing code. I don't have to rewrite this code. I can reuse it just by calling it whenever I want to. And just to prove that the computer will ignore it unless it is called, if I delete all of these calling lines and run it again, I will just see welcome and then goodbye. Despite having two perfectly valid lines at the top, they're ignored because it's in a definition for a subprogram. I've not actually called that sub-program yet, which is why it doesn't ever run. Now, just to put in a few more things I want you to know about before we end this video. Well, first of all, sub-programs have got a few different names, and helpfully, different programmers call these by different names. Subroutines is, I would say, the most common alternative for sub-program. At A level, it's called subroutine, unfortunately. It's a little bit confusing. It confused me a lot as a student. Subroutine, sub-program, same thing. I often slip into calling it a subroutine because I'm more used to that term, but they mean the same thing. So, programming languages have lots of built-in sub-programs already. You would have used lots of sub-programs which are considered built-in. That means they are available to use straight away in your programming language. Things like print and input and int, we don't see the definitions of these sub-programs, but they do exist somewhere on our computer in one of the hidden files of Python, whatever language you're using. Built-in sub-programs are provided to help us just by saving time, doing stuff ourselves, but also some of these things here are very technically challenging. I would have no idea how to code a print function, so it's done for us because it would be very difficult to do on your own. However, of course, you can also define and use your own sub-programs. That's what I just showed you. The greeting one I just showed you was one I wrote myself. It wasn't built into the language. You can define your own ones. You just have to write the definition yourself. And as I've alluded to, there are two main types of sub-program at GCSE, which we'll look at separately, but I want to just get in your head these terms. Now, we've got procedures and we've got functions. So they're very similar in structure, just with a slight tweak, which we have to understand. Procedures do not return a value in their code. Functions do return a value. And I'll explain what that means when we come on to the functions video. Procedures, which will be the next one, I won't show returning because procedures don't return a value. So we'll look at how procedures work in the next video, and I'll look at some exam style questions.